So just yeah, just okay. Welcome to all of you for joining in. Just a quick round of about what KK Biotech is. So our aim is to bridge the gap between academic programs, reality, and employability for the youth interested in pursuing biotechnology. We have started this series on scientists who live so that humanity lives longer and healthier. Today we are focusing on the work of Karl Landsteiner and what is in the impact today. Earlier we had talk on contributions of Ella Prakada Subbarao, Frederick Sanger, and Louis Pasteur. Now also we hold this talk on 23rd of every month, but hopefully we will change the thing, but this doesn't seem to be a very convenient day, so we might shift it to a Saturday or a Sunday in the coming time. Okay, so we have created what is called the Biotechnology Education for Student and Teachers Club, and this is one of the things. Also we do what is called internship, and we want teachers, postdocs, you know, we try to help them out to make their optimum use of their talent. So we recently did a workshop following things that, you know, revision of concepts and techniques with experts in the field of protein sequencing, proteomics, genomics. And then second week we had a clinical application of hematopoietic stem cells. Third week we had on LC-MS. Fourth week had cytometry, etc. So it was about a month's program. And the last one was on food technology and what is in SIBMAC. Okay. So these are all conducted by the experts in the field, and students have considerably benefited by this. So today, our last, today's talk is by Sanmukh Joshi, who has worked in this field from 1981. So you can imagine he has been literally at it at various places. About him, I'll just introduce in a short while from now. And Shivakumar will speak on his work and also focus on how lectins can be used to do the fine resolution. Okay. So just one. Yeah. Okay. So I'll stop presenting, and Sanmukh Bhai, you can get ready to start sharing. I'll introduce Sanmukh Joshi, whom I've known for last, since 1988, to be precise. So Sanmukh Joshi did his BSc from Gujarat University, MSc, PhD from Bombay University. He worked with a very famous man called Dr. Bhatia, who discovered the Bombay blood group way back in 1952. Then he joined the Institute of Immunohematology, and he was also sent for training in advanced. Sanmukh Bhai, start sharing your slide. Get your slide ready. While I introduce you, you go about okay. It. Yeah. Okay. So he learned about advances in blood grouping sera in UK and also cryopreservation of blood in Russia way back in 1984. He has worked with the Indian Institute of Immunohematology from 1972 to 85. At various levels, then moved to Higher Institute of Technology in Libya as lecturer and taught hematology, blood banking, immunology, and lab management to undergraduate students. Then after that was between 85 to 89. Then he joined as associate professor at Department of Transfusion Medicine, SGPGI, Lucknow, taught PG students who are enrolled for MD in transfusion medicine. Sanmukh Bhai, any problem uploading your slide?
No, actually, slide is now maximized. Eh? I don't know whether you can see that.
No, we can't see it because you have not shared it.
Okay. I'm sharing.
First, go to the arrow, full screen, then what you have minimized, you click on PowerPoint, it will come. Then he moved to the regional blood center called Surat Raktadan Kendra, which is part of the GS Medical College, as the director from 1992 to 98. Then he moved to the Red Cross Blood Center in Mumbai as director from 1998 to 2002. Then he moved as senior lecturer at the Institute of Health Sciences, Ministry of Health, Oman from 2000 to 2011. So taught, postgraduates at this thing. Then he also, worked in Malaysia as a visiting faculty, okay? His research interest lies in the field of hematology and blood transfusion. Published over 60 papers, and he has also discovered new blood groups for which he has a credit in the name, as it is called IN blood group, that is Indian to show it. And and he has discovered new phenotypes, etc. He also has worked on lectins, and he discovered a novel and potent source of anti-H lectin in Momardica deuica, an Indian plant called Kantola by locals. And he is very well known, and he is invited to all the immunohematology conference. So over to you, Sanmukbhai. Any problem sharing? We can't see your slide.
That is what I am trying now.
If you have a problem, I'll share it from my end. Did you go to the arrow?
Yeah.
Okay. A full screen. Yeah, good. It is coming now. Yes. Now you press on your minimized one, the PowerPoint, please. Yeah, good. Then you go to that cup and make it larger screen. Yeah.
All right. Should I start now?
Yeah, please do start. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you very much, Dr. Cannon, to give me an opportunity to be with your friends and discuss some of the interesting facet about Dr. Lehnsteiner, who is father of immunohematology or blood groups. Actually, Dr. Karl Lehnsteiner was an Austrian biologist and physician, better known for his discovery of human blood groups, but had multifarious achievements in biomedical field. Some would describe him as the father of blood group serology. Others would call as father of immunology, immunohematology, forensic medicine, anthropology. Today, let us peep into his life and work, as has tremendous impact in human lives. Despite the financial hardship Dr. Lehnsteiner faced during the early years of his career in his native Vienna, he never gave up his beloved research, contributing many important scientific findings during these lean times. Dr. Lehnsteiner was mentored by some of the leading scientific minds of his time, which helped him to expand his already intellect and delve further in his research. Possessing high intelligence and a tireless work ethic, Karl Lehnsteiner was a scientific pioneer who changed the face of medical treatment forever. His life was a living monumental defining. Success is equal to intelligence multiplied by hard work and divided by waste of time. If waste of time is zero, then one can get success that much infinite. That is what the formula says. If you look into the childhood of his, he was born on June 14, 1968 in Vienna, Austria. He was a lone child of Leopold Lehnsteiner and Fanny Hest. Father was a journalist, lawyer, newspaper publishers. And Lehnsteiner used to believe that he inherited from his father a great self-control, logical thinking, and a strong tenacity. From mother, he got a great modesty and reserved attitude. He lost father at six, so was raised by mother. He was attached to her so much that her death mask was hung on his wall throughout his life. He was a brilliant student in school, was permitted to begin studies at the university at 17 years, and graduated with degree in medicine in 1891. He did apprenticeship in organic chemistry in the medical lab. He preferred to be a research scientist rather than the medical practitioner because he felt that the future of medicine lies in the research. His Jewish background would hinder scope to become professor, so he converted to Catholicism and baptized as Karl Otto Jensteiner. He started his research career as, you know, the first research work that was done was on influence of diet on composition of blood ash, which was published in 1891.
No, it should be 1891.
Sorry. Yeah, correct. Because the 1991 is our area.
Yeah.
He studied chemistry in Switzerland and Germany. He became an assistant to known bacteriologist von Gruber to study the nature of immunity and antibodies, the laws of specific bacterial agglutination, and development of Vidal test for typhoid. Now, looking at the discovery of human blood groups that he made, it stemmed into observation made by Landois in 1875, when the RBC of one animal, that is, say, lamb, were mixed with serum of other animals, say, dog, got hemolyzed. Inspired by Landois, he did similar mixing experiments using RBCs and plasma from humans. The experiment was like this. He collected blood samples from his colleagues, separated serum and suspended RBCs in saline. A drop of cell was mixed with serum and observed red cell clumps caused by agglutinins in two types showing three patterns, one with A, second one with B, and third one with both. None of their serum reacted with own RBCs. Now, De Castello and Sturley, his students, found fourth group as AB with no agglutinin present in the serum. Now, this is what here, this is the table that he has published in his paper, and one can see even Lenstein's own samples are tested. He seems to be O group. So also is another one. Now, then he formulated the law. Lenstein believed that four groups were normal features, not due to history of disease. These four groups were classified based on presence of agglutinin that caused red cell clumping. And that was called agglutinin, or red cell clumping, rupture. That was called hemolysin. We think now blood groups in terms of antigen on RBCs and antibodies in serum that specifically combine with each other. Lenstener formulated this law that if antigen was present on RBC, antigen called agglutinogen at that time. So if agglutinogen was present on RBC, the corresponding agglutinin was absent in serum and vice versa. Now this association, reciprocal association of antigen on red cell and antibody serum made, you know, blood transfusion, blood grouping before transfusion as a mandatory procedure. Now beyond ABO group, you see, then he discovered MN blood groups. Discovery of ABO was relatively easy as naturally occurring antibodies were present in the human blood. Group C, later called group O, had no A or B antigen, so was curious to know if any antigenic difference exists among O. he and Divine, in 1927-28, injected animals with O group RBCs, and resultant immune serum was absorbed. Differential absorption of this immune sera revealed an existence of different antigens, and they called it as M. Other such immune sera called anti-N and anti-P were also revealed after absorption, selective absorption immunization. Anti-M and anti-N behave like an anti-physical antibody, so they probably belong to the antigen within the one system, one blood group system. Now then, there was a very important discovery of Rh blood groups, clinically significant blood groups, to study the phylogenetic difference among the humans and the primates. Lensteiner and Wiener immunized animals using RBCs of rhesus monkey. The resultant antibody was tested with human RBCs. Some 80% of human RBCs were agglutinated by that antibody, so was named as anti-rhesus. The name antigen as rhesus with short note as Rh. Now, there was a human anti-Rh was also found by Levine and Stetson. The case of human anti-Rh was found by Levine and Stetson in 1939, a year before, in a woman delivered a baby with hemohydrocephalus. The mother required transfusion and her husband belonged to the same group, ABO group, so was transfused, to which she developed a hemolytic transfusion reaction. She was found to have agglutinin that clumped husband's RBC as well as some 80% of the other white individuals. Test on her antibody in parallel to anti-rhesus, because anti-rhesus was also giving reactivity with 80% of the people. So they did common test. So this test on her antibody in parallel to anti-rhesus showed similarity, so was this human agglutinin was named as anti-Rh. It was deduced that anti-Rh produced in human is clinically significant to cause hydrocephalus and blood transfusion reaction to incompatible pregnancy or transfusion. Now, beyond the blood groups, he did quite a good number of research, and his study was based on the concept of an antibody fits an antigen as a key fits to a law. The concept remained basis to understand the mechanism of serological, immunological, and enzymatic reactions. With Erwin Popper, he discovered and related isolated the polio virus and worked towards the development of vaccine. He studied tuberculosis, isolated Clostridium septic bacillus. He played a pivotal role in the study of cytokines and hemagglutinins. His research was interrupted by a severe financial crisis, and he worked for a long time in Netherlands, Holland. The turning point came in his life was in 1923, when the director of the Rockefeller Institute of Medical Research in New York invited him to work in the field of immunology. He studied azoproteins, antigenic difference among serum proteins in different species, the role played by rickettsia during typhus fever, and studied the allergy and passive transfer of tuberculin-sensitive lymphocytes. And in 1927, he revisited the blood groups work again, and here discovering 20 new blood groups, including M and, as I already mentioned, P and Rh, as said earlier. This led to the development of modern paternity and forensic tests. During this, there is something is hidden here, one line. He successfully cultured the causative agent for typhus.
You you reduce that hide, click on the hide, it will disappear.
Okay.
That one which is interfering with you, just click on the hide. Hide on that, after that blue. Blue, next to the blue, not the, one. Okay, now it is gone.
Now, awards and achievement what he received is in 1927, Carl Lensteiner received an honorary degree from the University of Chicago. 2 years later, became president of American Association of Immunologists. He received honorary degree from both Cambridge and the Free University of Brussels in 1934, as well as an honorary degree from Harvard 2 years later. A century-old theory propounded by him on isointegrins is an accepted theory based on basis for immunology, tissue transplant, forensic medicine, and population genetics. He won the Nobel Prize in 1930 in the category of physiology and medicine, and the lecture gave was the conferment was based on the differences in blood of human individuals. Now, this picture shows Dr. Lensteiner. I don't know whether arrow goes to him. But on the extreme left side is our Dr. C.V. Raman, because at that time only he also got the Nobel Prize. So you can see for people who got the one, Hans Fischer got chemistry, Lensteiner in medicine, and Sindler Lewis in literature. And this is the Nobel certificate. You can see on left side, his name is there, Professor Carl Lensteiner. And other side, I can't read properly, nor I can understand what is written. Probably it is written in German language. Now, Lensteiner, somebody analyzed his work and observed that there was some similarity between Lensteiner and Albert Einstein, and doubted, questioned that Lensteiner is an Einstein of the biomedical science, and the analyzer was S. Srikanta. I don't know whether Srikanta is a female or a male, but analyze the contribution of Nobel laureates. Albert Einstein is the acclaimed peerless genius among the physical scientists, who could be equivalent among the biochemical scientist? That was the question for research for her or him. Lensteiner seems an appropriate choice according to Srikanta. Amongst 24 Nobelists in medicine who were born 15 years before and after Einstein, were considered as contemporaries of Einstein. Of this, contribution of Heidegger and Moniz have not stood to the test of time. Banting, who discovered insulin, and Waksman, who discovered streptomycin, their role was controversial because their juniors, collaborators, best colleagues, and chests were not given recognition for the discovery. Even Sergeant George Ski, who discovered ascorbic acid role, has also been question. Then, remaining 19 Nobelists in medicine can be grouped according to their research specialty as follows. In neurology, there are 7 people. In physiology and pathology, or physical medicine, they are not grouped together, but Lensteiner is shown in pathology part. Then there is a biochemistry and microbiology and surgery, all made pioneer contribution in their discipline. Then coming to the Lensteiner's significant discovery is in 1900 demonstrated the blood groups, ABO blood group existence. In 1903, the feasibility of grouping dried human blood stain and the usefulness of such testing in forensic medicine. In 1908, he first isolated the polio virus and demonstrated the use of monkey as an experimental model in polio research. In 1927-28, he discovered again the blood groups of MN and P and useful anthropological research with Philip Levine. And in 1940, he discovered the RH blood group system with the help of Alexander Wiener, which is a very clinically significant blood group system. Now, according to Srikanta, Nobel Prize criteria to assess significance of contribution is when assessed on the three criteria, namely the influence in multiple disciplines, revolutionary in opening new vistas in knowledge, and significant impact to human life. The work of Leinster stands out prominently as trend-setting discoveries between 1900 and 1940 permitted successful blood transfusion in human and gave life and hope to millions. What made Leinster such a trendsetter? He applied his chemistry knowledge to the clinical problem of transfusion reactions, and the result was the discovery of ABO groups and the theory of chemical immunity. So whenever there is a one discipline meets the another discipline, or one horizon meets the another horizon, a new horizon starts. So this is what was true with Dr. Leinster. His observation of specificity of isoantibodies in human blood opened up the field of blood groups of such great feature importance in blood transfusion, immunogenetics, and anthropology. And here, Srikanta compares between Einstein and Leinster in his life activity. Einstein begins his activity in Switzerland, whereas Leinster began his activity in Austria. Einstein flourished in Germany, and Leinster flourished in Netherlands, in Europe. And Einstein concluded in USA. So also Leinster concluded his activity in USA. So that is what Srikanta wants to emphasize. Now, another important features about Dr. Leinster was that he was an utmost modest person. One can say, modesty thy name, Karl. He was a man of a solitary nature and preferred to live away from other people or like that. He never gave any interviews on his revolutionary work in truth, impact. With typical modesty on generosity, he suggested the question asked to him that Thomas Hunt Morgan might be a more suitable recipient than him. That was his modest. But then in 1933, after 3 years, Morgan was also awarded the Nobel Prize for his discovery of chromosomal crossing over and his study of sex-linked inheritance. Again, talking about his modesty, despite his success, Leinster always remained modest and avoided all publicities, although he worked with the famous personalities like Kaltuff, who discovered, described Hodgkin's lymphoma in his breakthrough discoveries. His friend used to say he was averse to be praised, was so honest that he never achieved complete happiness in his personal life. The Hans Zinsser, I have read his very thick book in immunology. Zinsser, a famous colleague of his in immunology, at the Harvard Medical School, used to tell him, Carl, you are always happy, always complaining. He used to find greatest satisfaction in his solitary scientific work. Dr. Leinster was an excellent pianist, and he was also known to bring his beloved dog, Valdi. His dog's name was Valdi. He is led with him and let him sit underneath his desk. Now, in personal life, in legacy, he was born, as I already told you, in 1968 in Baden bei Wien. This is the exact place, which is 26 kilometers south of Vienna, a summer residence of the emperor of that time. His father, Leon Paul, a Jew cultural elite, he got Karl at his 50 years. And Leon Paul was 50 years, he got a baby, Karl. And then his father died 6 years later to heart attack. Mother Franziska, shortly called Fanny, grew up Karl later. After the loss of his parents, he underwent a period of grief, sorry, grief. He married in 1966. Always, he used to always shield his wife and son, Ernest, from any publicity, probably because he was a Jew. There was some anti-Jews sentiment in the European population. So maybe he wanted to keep them away from the publicity. Here there are four photographs. His father, his mother, then Stella, and his wife, Helen. His son's photograph I could not find anywhere, but he was there until 2007. He died at the age of 89. He was a neurosurgeon, and he studied at Harvard Medical School Medicine. With his family, he migrated to USA, relocated to New York and New York City in 1923. He was granted citizenship after 5 years and worked till 1939 up to his retirement. He continued to teach as Professor Emeritus at Institute. On June 24, 1943, Lemsteiner had a heart attack in his laboratory with his pipette in hand, as he always used to wish. He died 2 days later in the same hospital at the Rockefeller Institute. This is his very nice photograph that I could get it from internet. And this is in his laboratory. And this is the family tree. Actually, I could get, I must thank to my daughter, Marcy, who got me this information, figured out this information while she is in the North America. And one can see, I have 5 generations of springs. Now, by popular demand, I take opportunity to give glimpses of discoveries made by India, by our country. If we talk about blood groups, over more than 375 antigens are recorded as by 2020, classified into 43 systems as per genetic association, discovered in 120 years. All these antigens were discovered in 120 years, mainly from the West. India has also made respectable contributions. The summarized account on discoveries made in Indian soil is displayed in the following table. Pierce and Reed in USA, New York Blood Center, have compiled data in a book named Bloody Brilliant, A History of Blood Groups and Blood Groupers, which was an American Association of Blood Bank press release in 2016, where they have widely put up our discoveries of Indian blood groups and Bombay groups. Now, talking about the Bombay group, which was discovered in India by my professor, Dr. H. M. Bhatia, in 1951, while searching a matched blood for a patient met with a railway accident. Apparently, group O, none group O matched due to antibody in the serum. A month later, another patient with similar features matched with that first case, but again not matching with any other O group. A deliberate search yielded one more donor, with similar features. So these three blood helpers will refer to blood group reference unit, insert unit in UK, and they define as a new blood group named later as Bombay group. The frequency initially found as 1 in 30,000 people, that was improved when large number of samples were tested as to 1 in 7,600. The state-wise distribution was maximum in Maharashtra, about 122 cases, in Karnataka 15, and Andhra integrated 8, Goa 6, and Gujarat 5. And some sporadic cases from other states were also observed. There was an absence of high frequency antigen H in Bombay group, RBC, with naturally occurring regular yellow anti-H was always present in plasma. This discovery of Bombay group led understanding the biosynthetic pathway of the ABO blood group system antigens. Then we have Indian blood group antigens. We gave the name Indian. That was an extra antibody in grouping anti-sera. Anti-sera, which was used for blood grouping for Rh, in anti-D, there was an extra antibody we found and separated by absorption that was reacting with RBCs of about 2 to 3% of donors in Mumbai. The sample was sent to BGRL, Blood Group Reference Laboratory in London, and there it was confirmed that it was not belong to any existing antigen, and so it was new, and we can give any name we want. And we gave Indian antigen, and because it was first of its kind, we gave in I and A. The antibody was also present in 30 different NTD reagents prepared during that time. That implies that some Rh negative patients were erroneously typed receiving B positive blood transfusion. We do not know, or we don't have any record, that out of this, how many developed that unwanted anti-Rh antibody. Several Rh negative were immunized by. Why this antibody was present always in NTD? Because several Rh negative donors were immunized by RBCs of one person, who had incidentally INA antigen. Because the same person red cells were used in immunization to several Rh negative donors for production of NTD. The discovery paved way for in identifying antithetical antibody to anti-INB, because anti-INB was recorded as Salis antibody in UK, and then because it was reacting with every cells, nothing could be done at that time. When INA was discovered, at that time they reviewed that Salis antibody, and they found that it was antithetical to anti-INA. So they gave the name as anti-INB, renamed that as anti-INB, and the antigen detected was called as INA. And then INA and INTB were antithetical to each other, means if one is absent, other is always present. A new blood group system, with this INA and INB, a new blood group system was born, and it was named as Indian, and which was got recognition by International Society of Blood Transfusion as IN023. That was later expanded by other antigens, IN3 through IN6, of which IN5 was again discovered in 2016 in my lab here in Surat. Now, anti-INP was named as INRA because IN for India and RA for first two letters of the producer, antibody producer's name. So another antibody was found in matching test for BT, the transfusion, suspected specificity within the Indian system because of the reactivity. Other existing antigens were ruled out to confirm having a new antigen. Molecular typing showed a novel homozygous missense mutation in exon 5 of CD44 encoding PRG9150H as histidine amino acids substitution at the protein level. A novel antigen named INRA, as I told you, which was ISBT-IM05 in the series and was very rare, as was not found among the 5,000 donors tested serologically or by high throughput molecular approach in collaboration with NIH Maryland Bethesda. Then more recently, a new blood group system was evolved from India, and it was based on EMM antigen, which is a high frequency antigen, but only few cases were reported with that EMM negative being an ultra rare, 9 cases in the world. Then we got, and its genetic was not known, so did not find a system status to this. We encountered a case from Rajkot, and then the family study was carried out and genetics was defined and a new blood group system status was assigned at the ISBT Congress in 11th of December 2020. And as I told you earlier, that there are this many, 25 different features, new features, or some of them, they're all not new, but very rare and first time in India. And this is very busy slide. I do not expect that everyone can read this, but then you can see that actually I have been lucky to be involved in the discoveries where there are all highlighted features shown in this. With this, I will conclude my talk, and I thanks for your patience listening. Yeah.
I think the floor is open to questions. So anybody wants to ask a question, feel free to ask. Dr. Joshi,
yeah.
How did this blood banking come spread so much? I mean, what is blood your guess? How many people's lives would have been saved all over the world due to blood banking?
Actually, that statistics may not be available now, but it seems that whenever we have meetings, and whenever, these patients, we call it them sometimes, and donors, and then patients refers that particularly for my blood, present blood bank, that they always praise blood bank because some of them, they received 27 units of blood and so she was saved.
Okay.
During the hemorrhage, during the delivery program. So, actually, it seems it is the saving life of many. Yes.
So, how did this blood banking, what Red Cross was the main one which helped in spread of collection of blood?
Yeah.
And how did people were convinced that they should donate blood?
See, actually, for convincing people to donate blood, one has to have a motivation program. And then, actually, we conduct various meetings. Yes, we conduct, we distribute leaflet and we go to school and colleges, give lectures, and we spread the message that giving blood is a life-saving measure and it is a sacred entity. And then we use some of the gimmicks like, some of the religious work. We last for 8 days together. Similarly, we make a program that we have continuous blood collection program for 8 days, one after the another. At that time, we collected 5,000 units of blood over a period, and then we distributed to various blood banks. So, and then some religious leader, because India religious people have made good impact. So, one of the religious leader wanted to have a blood donation drive on his birthday, and in one day, they wanted to collect maximum blood in all over Gujarat. So that is what some of them they do that, you know. Hello.
Yeah. You can stop sharing your slide.
Okay.
Any other questions?
Karna, can I come in?
Yeah, please do. Waiting for you to ask the question.
This is not Carl Landsteiner. There was one slide which showed that Zenti-Argy was criticized for vitamin C. I wonder what was the criticism?
Ascorbic acid, yeah.
He has better contribution in discovering TCA cycle enzymes more than Krebs. But what was the controversy for ascorbic acid?
Ascorbic acid, vitamin C, no? The information I presented was extracted from very many sources.
And so what was the controversy in that time?
Has mentioned about this, that actually discovery of ascorbic acid was his contribution was in question. So that's why actually she filtered out some of those.
Professor Muralidhar wants to know what was the controversy. Do you know about it?
No, I don't know the controversy.
Okay. Can you just stop share presenting, Dr. Joshi?
I can stop.
Stop presenting. Stop presenting is coming, no, on your slide.
No, I will stop presenting.
No. But look at the blue one. Stop presenting is there. Go up. Yeah, you can see a blue one, no? Light showing. Come down. Yeah. Go to the right. There's a blue one, no? Stop presenting.
Okay.
Come down. Here on the left. Where our photos are appearing, no? Below that, there is stop presenting. On the left. Okay. Okay.
Now, actually, I want to ask question to Dr. Shiv Kumar.
Let him make the presentation, then you ask him, no?
Okay.
Because it's not fair to ask him without what he wants to say.
I will ask him.
No. Yeah.
No, that's fine. Interest is elective. Okay, go ahead.
Yeah, so thank you so much, Sanmukh Joshi, for taking us through and showing that in India has contribution in this field, right from Professor Bhatia till now, and you are also contributing to the discovery of a new blood group. I'm sure it is a big challenge for transfusion medicine. It might match with AB group, but that's not the end of the story. There are other reactions which are happening, as you rightly said, and you talked about anti-Rh factor, what happened. Now you are saying there are other cases. So I think there are some rare cases who have to be handled. So an expertise like you is required to advise what to do. So thank you so much, Dr. Sanmukh Joshi. Now I hand over to Professor Shiv Kumar.
Yes, I'll start sharing my slides.
So you can start. You start sharing. So Professor Shiv Kumar did his PhD from CFTRI Mysore in biochemistry with Dr. Rajgopal Rao. Then he was in Institute of Science as a postdoctoral fellow with Professor M.R.S. Rao. And from there, he joined the School of Life Sciences in Hyderabad University. And then, he's one of the guys who has had a lot of collaboration in Germany. You know, the number of universities he has collaborated is unbelievable. One is Munster, and is Würzburg, Göttingen, where he did a lot of his interesting work. And then, Greifswald. And he's basically has been studying on evolution of mannose 6-phosphate receptors, which he'll be talking about. Also lysosomal enzymatic sorting. And since he's going to present his work, and he did his PhD on lectins. So he's going to share his experience of what he does, plus how lectins final final resolution of blood grouping. So over to you, Professor Shiv Kumar. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Kannan. Am I audible, everybody, please?
Yes.
The screen is visible too. Full screen.
It is visible.
Okay, fine. Thank you very much, Professor Kannan, for this nice opportunity. It's lovely to be a part of this program always. And I have been at the University of Hyderabad since 1986, and my research interests have been in the field of glycobiology with emphasis on plant lectins and glycosidases. And more than two decades, I have been working on lysosomal biogenesis pathway from humans to Hydra to look at the evolutionary conservation of this biogenesis pathway. I would like to start this slide with paying respects and namaskarams to my supervisor, Dr. D. Rajagopal Rao at Mysore, where I learned all my biochemistry in terms of laboratory experience. And today what I am is largely because of his initial training. And he is the gentleman who connected myself and Kannan. This is a picture which was taken in one of the meetings in Delhi when both of us were present along with Dr. Rajagopal Rao. Now, the glycoproteins, as you know, are of different types in all living organisms. And some of these are present specifically to certain organelles, and some are localized on the plasma membrane, and some are freely floating in the cytosol. There are two distinct types of linkages, how the glycan portion can be linked to the polypeptide chain. One is called as the O-linked glycosylation, where serine or threonine residues in the polypeptide chain are linked covalently to the glycan structure. And all O-linked glycan structures are normally short chain structures. They are containing 5 or 6 carbohydrate residues of different combinations, and they are sequentially added onto the polypeptide chain by several glycosyl transferase enzymes. The second major types of glycoproteins are those which are linked through the asparagine nitrogen atom that is present at selective positions in the polypeptide chains. And these N-linked oligosaccharides are again of three distinct natures. All these oligosaccharides are essentially synthesized on a dolichol pyrophosphate, which is ER membrane bound lipid, where there is an assembly of the two N-acetyl glucosamine residues to the dolichol phosphate, followed by 9 mannose residues and then 3 glucose residues. This 14 sugar core oligosaccharide is what is primarily linked to the asparagine nitrogen atom through an oligosaccharide transferase enzyme co-translationally. And once these N-glycoproteins are formed in the ER with the mature protein exiting the ER and the Golgi, this undergoes several types of processing by various glycosidase enzymes. And there we get distinct types of sugar structures. One is called as a mannose rich type, where there is a large fraction of mannose residues, about 9 of them, attached to the 2 N-acetyl glucosamine residue and the polypeptide chain to which it is hanged. The second type is a complex type of oligosaccharide, where you have different monosaccharide residues. In addition, you also have a side chain fucose residue. There is a third type of oligosaccharide that is found in glycoproteins, which is called as a hybrid type of oligosaccharide, which has properties between high mannose type and complex type oligosaccharides. Below this cartoon, you find the structures of the sugar residues, which are actually present in these different types of oligosaccharides. So this, our work was majorly focusing on how the glycoproteins are actually processed, for which are they're destined to the lysosomes. Lysosomes are acidic vacuoles in all eukaryotic cells, which host about 50 different lysosomal hydrolases, which act at pH 5. All these different lysosomal hydrolases function at pH 5, and their ability to degrade biological material is a unique property of these different lysosomal enzymes. Thereby, the macromolecules that are not required by the cell are degraded and are reutilized in the cell because of the form several monomeric units on the macromolecules. Now, these lysosomal proteins, all of them are glycoproteins, and they contain N-linked glycan structures. So if you look at the next slide, this is a typical example of the N-glycan structure that is generated on the lysosomal enzyme in the ER. And then the glucose residues are removed by the glucosidase enzymes. And subsequently, the mannose residues are phosphorylated selectively by a phosphotransferase enzyme, which adds on N-acetyl glucosamine phosphate to a mannose residue as shown here. Subsequently, the N-acetyl glucosamine residue is removed, and the second phosphate group is also added to the branch mannose residue at the sixth position. And then a glucosaminidase enzyme removes the N-acetyl glucosamine sugar, thereby generating the phosphate groups on glycoproteins. That's all the lysosomal enzymes acquire this phosphate residue selectively in the Golgi apparatus. And this is what is recognized by two distinct receptor proteins that are present in the Golgi apparatus. These are called as the mannose 6 phosphate receptors. Because of the negatively charged phosphate group, arginine residues in the mannose 6 phosphate receptors that are selectively present at specific domain sequences can interact selectively with the phosphate groups, bind to them, and form a receptor ligand complex in the Golgi. And this exits from the Golgi and reaches an early endosome where, due to the acidic pH, the receptor ligand complex dissociates and the receptor returns back to the Golgi to continue the cycle, or it reaches the plasma membrane to internalize lysosomal enzymes or M6P containing ligands from the extracellular region. And this is how these primary different endosomes finally fuse to generate the lysosome structure, which hosts this large number of lysosomal hydrolases. The selective binding of the glycoprotein, that is the lysosomal enzymes, to the mannose 6 phosphate receptors is sugar dependent. So the mannose residues which are phosphorylated are now selectively identified by the receptor, and therefore these receptors are called as the P-type lectins. These P-type lectins were discovered initially in the 1980s by a group in Germany from the human liver tissue, and by a group in St. Louis from the bovine liver tissue. Professor Stuart Kornfeld extensively worked in St. Louis on the bovine receptors and lysosomal enzymes. Professor Kurt von Figura, with whom I was associated in Göttingen University, worked extensively on the human receptors and the human lysosomal enzymes. So these receptors bind and then transfer them to the lysosomes. Interest in this field essentially is because the absence of the phosphotransferase enzyme, which is involved in generating the phosphate group here, leads to what is called as eye cell disease. That means the lysosomal enzymes are formed in the ER, the glycan structure is present, but it is not phosphorylated due to the absence of the phosphotransferase enzyme. Therefore, the lysosomal enzymes do not reach the lysosomes unless they are phosphorylated and acquire the mannose 6 phosphate residues. They cannot be recognized by the receptors. Therefore, the newly synthesized lysosomal enzymes, if they lack the phosphate group due to the absence of the phosphotransferase enzyme, they are secreted out of the cell and they can never reach the cell again because they lack this recognition signal. And this recognition signal essentially defines actually that the lysosomal enzyme should be transported to the lysosome selectively once they are processed in the Golgi apparatus. So the eye cell disease is also characterized by presence of large number of inclusion bodies in the cells, because the lysosomal enzymes are not functional, thereby there is accumulation of undigested material in the cells. Now these receptor proteins are two different types. One is the cation-dependent mannose 6 phosphate receptor, and the small receptor or the cation-dependent mannose phosphate receptor. So the cation-dependent mannose phosphate receptor has a single cassette structure at the amino terminal domain, a short transmembrane domain, and a cytoplasmic tail, whereas the cation-independent receptor is a larger receptor with 300 kilodalton molecular mass, and it has 15 repetitive cassette structures at the amino terminal domain. Now, each of these 15 cassette structures are structurally related to one another and to the single cassette structure of the MPR46. Therefore, it is strongly believed that the MPR46, because of its simplest structure, could be the most ancient one in evolution. And by gene duplication, as the organisms have grown into multiple multi-organ structures and into complex organisms, this necessitated for the evolution of these different cassette structures to generate various functional units in the cells. So our interest was primarily to identify where exactly in the animal kingdom, in the evolution, both receptors started appearing for the first time. So we started with the mammalian species and went down to the birds, reptiles, amphibians, and fish, and found that both receptors are evolutionary concert with similar structural motifs and similar ligand binding domain sequences from fish to mammals. So the vertebrates are now thoroughly known that they are highly evolutionary conserved processes. Therefore, the lysosomal biogenesis pathway is similar from fish to mammals. Then we went on to the invertebrates to check in the echinodermates, starfish, and in the mollusks. And we found that both species also contain the distinct receptors, which are homologous to mammalian counterparts. Interestingly, when we looked at the drosophila sequences available at the time, we found that the drosophila lack the protein, but they contain a receptor which is a truncated form of the cation independent receptor. It has only 9 domain structures, but it fails to bind the lysosomal enzymes. For some reason, the sequence similarity between the drosophila receptor and the human receptor is less than 25%. But drosophila has lysosomal enzymes. The question comes, how are the lysosomal enzymes are transported in the drosophila? Here comes, possibly there are selective lectins or other proteins or other regions of the receptor are involved in the transport. For example, the cytoplasmic tail of the receptor could be involved. The mannose-6-phosphate binding domain is poorly conserved in the drosophila as compared to the human receptor. And it's also an incomplete receptor. We found it has only 9 cassette structures. Having known this information, we wanted to look it at other animal models, and we bumped into Dr. Suren Ghaskadbi from Agarkar Research Institute, Pune, who was working on Hydra vulgaris. As a developmental biologist, he was looking at cell signaling processes in Hydra and in developmental biology of Hydra. So we asked him whether we could use his animal model, and he very generously donated his Hydra model system to us, and we learned how to culture the Hydra from him, and we established now very good protocols in our laboratory at the University of Hyderabad to use this model system to understand the lysosomal biogenesis pathway. More recently, we found by biochemical evidence as well as by cloning strategies, we found that the 46 receptor or the cation dependent receptor of Hydra is exactly similar to the human counterpart. So the evolution of the receptor is very, very ancient, Hydra being one of the ancient organisms, and it has been 46 receptor is found from Hydra to humans. However, when we look for the cation independent receptor, we found that it is also a truncated receptor with 1, 2, 3, and 4 domain structures only. But interestingly, the domain 2 structure is very much homologous to the domain 3 structure of the human receptor, which harbors the mannose-6-phosphate containing ligand region. So the Hydra receptor possibly functions, although in a truncated form, in the transport of lysosomal enzymes in the Hydra. This is what we are currently evaluating to understand. For sure, the mannose-6-phosphate ligand binding regions of the Hydra 46 protein are highly conserved compared to the human receptor. So this cartoon here shows that the cysteine residues are conserved. In addition, the arginine residues involved in the ligand binding are also conserved between human and Hydra for the large receptor. And superimposing the structure of the large receptor from, we find that the binding regions are highly conserved. So our work on this has clearly established that the lysosomal biogenesis pathway is very, very ancient in evolution, and certainly Hydra vulgaris, the early cnidarian, already has lysosomal biogenesis pathway. We have characterized, identified several lysosomal enzymes, and we need to further confirm the stoichiometry of binding between the receptor and the ligand and other biophysical experiments we would like to conduct in future to unequivocally establish that this pathway is very ancient in evolution. This has been the story since the last 2 decades, and many thanks to several of the students who have contributed to this knowledge. The second part of the work, what we are carrying out, as Kannan asked me to find, let people know also what we have been doing with respect to plant glycosidases and plant lectins, how to determine the glycan structure of a glycoprotein. I take a typical example of a plant glycosidase. It's called as a mannosidase, which is responsible to remove mannose residues from glycoproteins. So we used the jack bean seed alpha mannosidase enzyme, whose sequence information and the glycan structures were unknown. And we used this protein, the purified protein, and by multiple proteolytic digestions, obtained a large number of fragments of peptides. And we had to do several rounds of digestions, different time periods and so on. And using different enzymes in solution, we were able to generate large number of peptides, which were subjected to mass spec analysis. And then the sequence of the overlap peptides was designed. Additionally, we also were able to separate the enzyme on an SGS page electrophoresis, and then selectively I take the 46 kilodalton subunit and the 66 kilodalton subunit and the 44 kilodalton subunit of the enzyme and subject it to digestion by trypsin, chymotrypsin, and other enzymes and processing them for mass spec analysis. So jack bean mannosidase is a very important enzyme because it is commercially available and it is very much useful to understand the glycomics of various glycoproteins. So it is used in experiments to remove mannose residues and to understand the glycan structures. It has two subunits, and it was found that the large subunit essentially has the glycan structures. So what we found is, this is the sequence information we could generate. Total 981 amino acids, the larger subunit 562 amino acids with two potential N-glycosylation sites, NQT and NIS, but only one of them is occupied, as you see in the next slide. And also two intramolecular disulfide bridges in the larger subunit and one intramolecular disulfide in the smaller subunit. The smaller subunit also has one potential glycosylation site from the sequence studies. However, it is not occupied. It's only the larger subunit which has the glycosylation sites. Now, this is again obtained by the fragment ion in the spectrum. We get the sequence of the peptide where the N-glycosylation site is actually attached in the linkage here. And these are the two N-acetyl glucose amino acids. This is the core oligosaccharide, which is already processed. And we find that here, 1, 2, 3, 4, there are 8 mannose residues. And this number of mannose residues actually varies from protein to protein. This again depends on the levels of different glycosyl transferase enzymes that are present in that particular seed material and so on. Therefore, the mature glycoprotein, what we used, had only 8 mannose residues that are linked in differential linkages. And then this molecular mass of the glycopeptide was selectively identified by mass spec analysis, and also the intramolecular disulfide linkages surrounding the N-glycosylation site have been established. When we looked at the different other literature available information, we found that jack bean mannosidase sequence, what we have analyzed, is among other, including the bovine alpha mannosidase. That's the lysosomal mannosidase of bovine liver tissue. The lysosomal alpha mannosidase, an animal enzyme, is structurally homologous to the plant enzyme with the potential glycosylation sites that are highly conserved, and also the cysteine residues neighboring the potential glycosylation sites are also highly conserved. We also went on to look whether the active centers of the jack bean mannosidase are also involved in and are homologous to the mammalian enzyme. And we clearly find that the aspartic acid residues involved in the enzymatic activity, substrate binding activity, are highly conserved when compared to the bovine lysosomal alpha mannosidase and the jack bean mannosidase. This is the superimposed images of the active site of amino acid residues of JBM, that's the red, and with bovine lysosomal alpha mannose. So this suggesting that one can use mass spectrometric analysis not only to generate the primary sequence data of polypeptide chains, but also to understand the N-glycan linkages, how these are linked to the polypeptide chain, and what is the nature of linkages among the within the glycan structure and also within the glycoprotein. So from this study, we concluded that the high mannose type structure was found to be present in highly conserved N-glycosylation site that is present in all acidic alpha mannosidases from algae to mammals. And this was published in Glycobiology, the core glyco journal, in 2014. And Nanesh Kumar, my student who worked a lot of studies on this, currently a scientist C at CFTRI Mysore. Now, coming to the field of lectins, what we have been working, we are interested in looking at developing active methods to purify wide variety of lectins from plant sources and from animal sources. And plant lectins, that is where I gained my first experience in research with Rajagopal Rao at Mysore, where we developed affinity gels binding mannose sugar to saffron activated with divinyl sulfone, a bifunctional reagent. Now, this gel matrix prepared can be used to purify any mannose containing lectin. So I exploited this matrix to such an extent that I was able to couple a wide variety of monosaccharides and disaccharides such as even lactose. In addition, oligosaccharides like phosphomanooligosaccharides from yeast, which I used to purify the mannose phosphate receptors. So one can selectively covalently bind different glycan structures or independent monosaccharides or disaccharides to saffron activated with divinyl sulfone. The advantage of this activation process is that it can be run at room temperature for 70 minutes, and then the coupling is done overnight at 4 degrees centigrade, and the gels are so stable. I'm so happy that even after 20 years, we could still reproduce without any problem the affinity matrix and its ability to bind the receptors or the lectins, what we have developed. Here I give some examples of blood group specific lectins. These lectins are found not only among the leguminous seeds, which they were earlier detected from, but they're also found in a wide variety of other plant families. And mostly the seed materials are the primary source of these proteins and also lectins. Our main interest also has been to look at the physiological significance of these lectins, because they lectins and plant glycosidases also show specific interactions. Just as we have seen in the mannose phosphate receptor is binding to lysosomal enzymes at pH 7 and it is then released at pH 5. And this is a specific interaction between the glycosidases in eukaryotes and in the animal species, the P-type lectins. Similarly, the plant lectins are also able to bind with plant glycosidases at selective pH. So we are trying to understand what is the physiological significance and where these are localized within the seed material. So I give three examples here. One is the O blood group specific lectin, which is actually used to understand, which is able to recognize the fucose sugar that is present on the glycan structure of erythrocytes of O group erythrocytes. So this lectin essentially, it binds and causes visible agglutination. So there's a multivalency, a large number of lectins cross-link with the sugar residues because the sugar binding pocket is also distributed across the polypeptide chain in the lectin, and then it can selectively bind specific sugars. So there are lectins from the lotus seeds and Ulex europaeus animal species, which are highly specific for L-fucose, which is present as a terminal sugar on the O erythrocyte membrane. So one can detect selectively O group erythrocytes by using these lectins. And these are purified glycoproteins. They can be purified again on fucose affinity gels. The purified proteins are tetrameric, dimeric, or even the monomeric form is 27 kilodalton. And most lectins are also requiring divalent metal ions such as calcium and manganese for binding the carbohydrates. The second important type of lectin which is recognized in blood groups is the A blood group specific lectins, which are recognizing the terminal sugar NGL galactosamine, GalNAc, which is present as a terminal sugar in glycoproteins. And this NGL galactosamine is present on the erythrocyte surface of egg erythrocytes. Therefore, some lectins from plants such as the Dolichos, the horse gram seeds, or from the animal species such as the Helix pomacea, a snail, glycine max, again a soybean seeds, and other legumes such as Phaseolus or Vichia villosa seeds, they contain selectively lectins which are able to recognize A blood groups alone. These cannot recognize O blood groups because they can bind, their sugar binding pockets are synthesized or structurally having the motif that can selectively recognize only the N-acetyl galactosamine. And more often, the N-acetyl galactosamine, to some extent, they also recognize galactose residue, but not so effectively, or they could also recognize a dimeric form like N-acetyl galactosamine and 3-galactose linkage also they will be able to detect. So these are again tetrameric glycoproteins, and some of them exist as isolectins, and they are able to distinguish between A group of erythrocytes. Then there are B blood group specific lectins, which contain galactose as the terminal sugar on the erythrocyte membrane, which is recognized by these lectins. These are again from different plant species such as the Griffinia simplicifolia and Sophara japonica seeds. They contain these lectins, which are selectively able to bind alpha galactose sugar in the erythrocyte membrane of B blood groups. Therefore, they are able to recognize the B blood group rather than A or O blood groups. These lectins are again purified by affinity chromatography, and then these are glycoproteins with molecular mass of 114 kilodalton, and each subunit consisting of 28.5 kilodalton. They also require calcium as the divalent metallions for the effective binding to the lectins. Thank you very much for your attention and the opportunity given.
Thank you, Shiv Kumar. I think you took us into the sugar world and how important sugars are. Only thing I want to know that if they are agglutinating, so suppose some of the people grow these, keep these seeds sprouted and eat, will it cause any problem to the blood?
Normally not, because this is, most of them, they are actually easily digestible once they reach the blood system. And sometimes, if it is not cooked properly, then they are likely that they are not completely digested in the stomach region or in the intestine. And then partly degraded lectins can still have the ability to bind on the erythrocyte on the intestinal cell surface and prevent absorption of minerals and other materials. Therefore, the partial lectins are actually resistant also to proteolytic degradation to some extent. Okay. They are not easily digestible, but since most of the seeds which they are containing and the sprouting seeds, as you said, we already use them in an active, in a sort of denatured form.
Okay.
In when we cook it, we denature, of course, but even if you do not cook and we eat the, we normally eat groundnuts, which also contain lectins. We don't cook the groundnuts, we simply roast it and then take the dried ones. The actually, Phaseolus vulgaris, the red kidney bean seeds contain a lectin that has to be thoroughly cooked before eating. We eat every raw Phaseolus vulgaris seeds because it does not get digested easily, and it prevents absorption of other nutrients from the.
Now I just want to ask, why do the
otherwise they are denatured in the cooking process and is no problem for the.
But what is the advantage for plants to have lectins in them? I mean, is it some defense mechanism?
Defense mechanism is one, and they're also, because of their specificity towards sugars, they are called as carbohydrate catchers. They are possibly involved in the transport of sugars also.
Okay.
Or with it, material where they are stored in what is called as protein bodies together with glycosidase enzymes and other storage proteins. And these protein bodies are exactly analogous to the lysosomes in the eukaryotes.
Okay.
So these are containing these glycosidase enzymes. Suppose in the process of germination, these protein bodies lyse, and then the proteins, lectins and storage proteins are available for degradation by glycosidase enzymes. So they remove the sugars initially, then the partly denatured proteins are digested by proteolytic enzymes and you get free amino acids. So they are serving as potential source of energy for the growth of the seedling.
Okay.
And the common localization in the protein bodies suggests they have a strong in vivo interactions as well. Just as you have the enzymes stored in the lysosomes, in the protein bodies, these are stored.
Can I ask a question here?
Yeah, sure. So sure, please go ahead.
Oh. Yeah. First of all, I want to thank Dr. Kannan for organizing this meeting, and also nice meeting Dr. Sanmukh Joshi and Dr. Shiva Kumar. A nice presentation. My question is, currently we are trying to purify IgA antibody from serum, and we are looking at what is the method or how we can try. And we came across Jacqueline from
jackfruit. Like seed.
You elaborate a little bit? Is it how good that method? Are you familiar with
that? That's a good method. Actually, it's very easy to purify the jackfruit seed lectin, because you get in plenty, and then you can just extract and pass on an affinity gel and purify. If you immobilize the jackfruit seed lectin on a gel, for example, on cyanogen bromide activated sucrose gel or on a FE gel from the BioRat sample, then you can actually bind the the lectin onto the gel, which is a stable affinity gel, and it can be used to bind your IgA.
So is it very specific to IgA?
Yes, it is specific. The Jacqueline seed lectin is specific to IgA.
Okay, and I was wondering why this plant system makes something specific to IgA. It has nothing to do with
I know we don't know the precise and some of these things.
Okay. Thank you. Yeah.
Most welcome.
Professor Muralidhar, you wanted to ask something? Yeah.
No, I don't want to ask, but I want to make two comments.
Sure, sir.
One is, for a long period of time, in the case of glycoproteins, people have been asking a crucial question. What is the role of this oligosaccharide or carbohydrate, as we call it? Whether it is only a structural motive for folding, or do they have any role in function? There's a lot of work on that. But the point I'm making is, we were working on glycoprotein hormones of pituitary, buffalo pituitary, and sheep pituitaries. These are glycoproteins. And for about 10 years in West, they were unable to sequence the sugars. Normally, you use either chemical method like diazomethane, or use glycosidases like mannosidase, galactosaminidase, and other things, and see sequentially remove the sugars and arrive at the sequence. Nothing worked. So 10 years. In 1983, I was a lecturer in University of Hyderabad, and we discovered that the N-acetyl galactosamine, which is a terminal sugar there, these are ACLO proteins, glycoproteins, and that had a sulfate. And we were wondering what is the role of this sulfate other than resisting enzyme and chemical reagents like diazomethane. When you talk of lysosomal proteins having mannose-6-phosphate as a marker so that they can be picked up by the receptor, you have some role there for the phosphate
moiety. Yes.
I wonder what is the role for sulfate. When we looked at function for these hormones, we found two isomers. One is a basic, that is the isoelectric point is a little high. Another is acidic, little low. And the acidic one has 6 sulfate moieties. Whereas the basic ones had only 1. But the problem is this. Biological activity at the gonadal end, these are gonadotropins, they work on gonads. The sulfated ones had 0 activity. It was picked up by liver. They never went to gonad. So why is the animal wasting its energy in producing a hormone which is not active? And the only difference is sulfate. We did a little chemistry on that. But then biologically, till today, we do not know what is the exact role of this sulfate. I wonder, is there any sulfated galactosamine binding lectin?
Not I know of, sir. It's only N-acetyl galactosamine binding lectins are only known, but sulfated.
That's the one thing. Animal pituitary hormones, they don't have sialic acid, whereas the human ones have sialic acid, and the penultimate sugar is galactose. The ACLO human proteins will be picked up by liver, Ashwell has done a lot of
right, Gilbert Ashwell, yes, yeah.
Whereas the Cl one will go to the gonad and plasma half-life is more. In the case of sulfate, we have no biology reports on that, except our work on the chemistry side. We did both the chemical work as well as other methods to identify and estimate this sulfate. We developed new method. This is all in 1983 letters publications. Till today, we don't know. When we were extending this work in Delhi, when I went to Delhi, we unusually found in another hormone, prolactin, not sulfated sugar. It's a big story. We found it on tyrosine. That was also a first discovery of the post-translation modification, unusual. Before me, there was only one paper, Jack's paper by Frinkel Conrad, who did a very, very unusual and eccentric work, effect of sulfuric acid on tobacco mosaic virus protein. And he isolated tyrosine O-sulfate from there. After that, our report, which is present part of the hormone, prolactin, and in that case also, we don't know the biological significance of this sulfated sugar. Again, there, we don't know whether there are any lectins which can recognize tyrosine sulfate, because major part of biochemistry is on phosphorylation, dephosphorylation.
Probably nobody has assayed for that problem.
Yeah, basically, these are all what we call new areas. We ourselves could not do much, but I hope somebody notices this and extends this and discover a new area of work on this. The other point I wish to make, that in this case of gonadotropin, follicle stimulating hormone, there are a number of glycosylation sites, N-glycons. If one of them is missing, 57 or some such thing, this doesn't go to gonad, it goes to bone. And bone has receptor for this gonadotropin, which is my student discovered it, and it's a Cell paper. And in postmenopausal women, where you see osteoporosis, this is due to this hormone and not as what doctors are telling, that you have low steroid. So these are some of the developments in other glycoproteins, especially hormones, which I am familiar. I'm just wondering whether there are lectins specific for this. That's all. Of course, I'm retired and I don't do any work.
Absolutely. Fair enough. Dr. Sanmukh Joshi, you wanted to ask a question. Please go ahead.
Yeah. Can you hear me?
Yes, please.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, as Dr. Kannan has mentioned about my work, actually, I have lectin NTH in Mumardica dioica, ROXB. And that lectin extract has peculiarities, you know, that if you add red cell directly in the aqueous solution of that extract, it immediately gets immolized. And if you add Bowen serum albumin, then hemolysis is arrested.
I see.
So why it could be due to, number one?
There is also a toxic component possibly in the lectin, what you have isolated from the seed extracts. See, some of these seeds, they have this ribosome inactivating factors. Some of them are there. That's one thing which may block the protein synthesis. For the lysis, possibly it is disrupting the membrane totally of the erythrocytes at high concentrations of the protein. Therefore, it is causing the lysis. And maybe BSA is partly protecting, therefore, it is. Is it restoring? BSA is preventing the lysis, or what is
this? Preventing. Whenever I want to use, I prepare extract and then neutralize that hemolytic activity with Bowen serum.
I think BSA binds anything, therefore, possibly it's pre masking the erythrocytes, therefore, it is preventing the lysis by the toxic component. That could be one possibility, this is my understanding.
Another aspect in this particular lectin is that it is NTH. I have tested several Bombay group blood and it is not reacting with that, and it is NTH only, but then it gets inhibited by milk from even Bombay group people. So actually, genetically, Bombay group people, they don't have H antigen as such.
Correct, correct.
Even in any fluid. Yet this FTH leptin is quickly inhibited by milk, other milk also, even cow milk also, but even Bombay group milk also.
Mm-hmm.
So what is that?
I don't know. I really have to see what could be there.
Two particular features of with this lectin.
Mm-hmm.
I think Shivakumar, you must look at this lectin bit more carefully.
Yeah, could be.
You know, because it may have some, because it's specific to anti-H. I'm sure it'll give a new feeling, because you said the O group has H group, no?
Yeah.
So you could easily assay for it, because Dr. Joshi is more an experimentalist, you know, of transplant, but he is quite keen, because he thinks he can resolve some issues probably if he has a purified one which doesn't do the lysis. Am I right, Joshi?
Correct.
Yeah, we could try to. Currently, we are actually working on Momardica carantia seeds, which has a galacto-specific.
That's also NTH-like. It is not exact NTH.
Correct.
It gives some non-specific reactivity with Bombay group cells. But this is dioica. You know, it is occurring everywhere, you know, from Kashmir to Kanyakumari and beyond in Sri Lanka.
Yeah, this is similar to what the Momardica carantia is our Karela.
Karela.
So
this is we call Kantola. In Gujarati, we call Kantola.
Yeah, similar to Karela only, that is.
Actually, but I have got a good amount of seeds. I will send you my paper.
Sure. Yeah,
on there, we can talk about that. You can guide me further.
Sure, sir. Definitely.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah. I think. Is there any other questions? I think I must, if there are no more questions, I would like to thank both Dr. Joshi and Professor Shivakumar for, illustrating, the basic aspect, which is very important in transfusion medicine, and Shivakumar talking on how plant lectins or animal lectins can be used for this thing. And it is very interesting, you know, what Professor Murli that said, sulfated one, what are the issues? Do we have a lectin for that? I think it's a very, the field is still very important, because transfusion medicine reactions are, you know, sometimes we don't understand. You blood group is matched, still there is a transfusion reaction. I think a lot of safety has to be done. And I think that's where Sanmukh Joshi has spent all his life, trying to give better transfusion. You know, people just think blood group is mad, give the blood. I think it is not that simple, as we could find out from what Dr. Joshi was saying. So I think if there are no more questions, Mani, you want to ask anything?
No, sir. Really, okay. It was enlightening in all respects. Thank you.
So if there are no more questions, I would like to thank both the speakers and all the audience who seriously participated. So thank you very much, and we look forward to this thing. Now probably I'll change the date to a Saturday or Sunday, so that people will have more time, because today has been too many faculty development programs. So many of my members couldn't attend, because they have been attending that session from morning till evening. So I think next time I'll make sure there's no clash of dates, okay? Otherwise we'd have had a good audience. So thank you, both of you. And look forward to this thing. And I would like to thank all of you.
Yeah, thank you very much, Karan. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much.
I'll take leave. Thank you, Dr. Joshi and Dr. Shivakumar. Wonderful.
Most welcome, sir. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you, Karna.
It's my pleasure.
I'll take leave.
Yeah, thanks all the audience. Yeah.
Thank you all. Good night.